Thank you so much. We're going to start now. I know people will keep... Nope, sorry. Not on the stairs. Yeah. And those of you just coming in, maybe you could start a floor movement at the front, please. A whole trend. Thank you very much. We have to... There's, just so you know, Sepp's marked out an area at the back which we need to keep clear. So you could just sort of egg people into the room. We'd appreciate that. Okay, welcome to Format. My name's Shumon Basar. Thanks so much for coming. Thanks to my guests this evening, to Guy Mannes-Abbott, to James Westcott, who I'll introduce in more detail very, very soon. Thanks also to Manny J, to Sepp, to Christina for setting this all up. We still have some of the excellent format, couple format posters by Wayne Daly. They're in the bin at the front, so please feel free to take them at the end of the session. Could you please turn your phones to silent right now? Thank you. Fantastic. Okay, so let's start. Hello, new person at the door. Come in. Okay, so Samuel Beckett once said about James Joyce's work in progress that form is content and content is form. A few decades later, Marshall McLuhan declared that the medium is the massage. Inspired by these words, format is about the shapes that discourse takes. What is the grammar of how we know or how we feel things? And if there are hidden politics presentation, what are they? This is the sixth issue of Format, a live magazine. Last year, we looked at notable career formats. At the core was an idea that life takes on a format, designed or undesigned, from which we might better understand our destinies. Over the last years, I'm sure some of you have noticed the rise of the couple portmanteau, which is when two names are synthesized together to create a new hybrid name. This name becomes clickbait, it becomes a media brand, and of course a kind of incredibly transmittable headline. In the portmanteau, individual identities are subsumed into a Siamese fusion. So inspired by a comment made by the filmmaker Jean-Luc Godard, when he described the identity between love and work, can we think of a working life together in tandem as something possessing shape or indeed format? A couple is, mathematically speaking, the smallest unit of collaboration and perhaps therefore the most potent and of course the most poisonous. Are couples design projects too? Do they have narrativity, predestination, and myth built into their wiring? And what exactly is unconscious uncoupling? When we think about our own future lives, paying heed to past couple formats, both successful and disastrous, both well-known and lesser-known, these may provide inspiration, solace, or simple guidance on how to be ourselves. To explore this further, we're inviting a number of notable guests to share with us one couple format that has, in retrospect, made some kind of mark upon them, either directly in what they do or indirectly in how they might approach this identity between love and work. Some of you were here on Wednesday when we were introduced to Charles and Ray Eames and Denise Scott Brown and Robert Venturi, two American architectural husband and wife duos separated by generation and the gap between modernity and postmodernity. And we talked a lot about how both of these couples, although their approaches, beliefs, and ideologies in architecture and the world maybe could not be more different, there was some resonance in how they seem to inscribe themselves as couples into the mythology of their own work, particularly through photography and thus world making. So I'd like to introduce our first guest this evening, Guy Mannes-Abbott. Guy is a London-based writer whose work often performs in visual art contexts, including his last book, In Ramallah Running. He's also contributed text to Eflux Journal's Super Community Project, and also Endnotes. He contributed to The Gulf, High Culture, Hard Labor, and collaborated with the artist group Camp on The Country of the Blind and other stories. He once taught theory here at the AA, and I can verify I was one of his students about 18 years ago. It was an incredible course and opened my eyes to many different ways of thinking about literature and the relationship between literature and the city, our bodies and how we tell stories with our bodies as we move through cities. And Guy's cultural criticism has been widely published, newspapers, and art magazines, journals, you name it. So will you please join me in welcoming Guy Mannes-Abbott, Gertrude Stein, and Alice B. Toklas. Thank you.
Thank you, Shumon. Welcome, everybody. So that image looks a bit antique after that, but I'll share your secret with you. I'm really only showing it to you for the hats, because I could have done this entirely about their hats, because they had these gorgeous hats. And bear in mind, they're very short, and those hats are about a meter tall in proportion. So that's an image from the 20s, and I love it. I settled on the playlist as my format, within format, both for some images and some love and work anecdotes. One, reputation, relation. I'll start by saying a little of the great deal that there is to say about Gertrude Stein. Gertrude might be well known, but actually I don't know what reputation she has today, its scale or its substance. I don't know what you bring to the room, as it were, nor what Gertrude Stein means beyond it. Also, I don't know what the reputational relationship is between her work and her life. However, Gertrude's work is, as she wished and asserted for it, elemental or emblematic of the modern age, European or Atlanticist 20th century, which she wrote, quote, America created, and which she captured in The Making of Americans, in her what she called the continuous present, which operates, she said, like the making of automobiles. In my experience, in the late 20th century, 18 years ago, Gertrude Stein was most closely associated with the autobiography of Alice B. Toklas. An immediate success in 1934 when it was published in terms of celebrity and generating her first ever earnings at the age of 60. But that has been replaced in this century by The Making of Americans, her cherished 1,000-page, 500,000-word book novel, which struggled so desperately to get published at all. The limited 1925 edition, which was 15 or 20 years in getting published, was not reprinted again in full until 1995. Americans itself was written a century ago, and we sit here together now knowing that we have never been modern. Lightning and thunder struck simultaneously when I first read Gertrude, and the words were absorbed in ways that remain very difficult to map. A little bit of Gertrude Stein went a very long way with me, taking the form of confirmation more than inspiration. It's clear that some of my early work bears an influence, but beyond rhythmic urgency, I or you would be hard-pressed to trace it. Gertrude's core texts remain, for me, the ones that render objects, food, and places in tender buttons, still mysterious and alluring, and those that more successfully engage the rhythms of people in her portraits. Plus some of the lectures in America and chapters in How to Write, which attempt to articulate her poetics. Let me just read you one little quote from her about that, if you will bear with me. She wrote, "I began to think about portraits of anyone. If they are themselves hidden inside them, what are they, and what has it to do with what they do? And does it make any difference what they do or how they do it? Does it make any difference what they say or how they say it? Must they be in relation with anyone or with anything in order to be one of whom one can make a portrait? I began to think a great deal about these things." She wrote that in the 30s. So the biography came much later for me, and is secondary as well as remarkable, inspirational, and aspirational. It is the love and work of Gertrude and Alice. Two. Who? Well, Gertrude was born in 1874 in Allegheny, now Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, the youngest of five siblings to second-generation immigrants from Germany. However, she spent her early years in Vienna and Paris before rejoining her father in Oakland, California, from the age of 6 through 17, when he died. Alice was born in 1877 in San Francisco, the eldest child, only daughter, and little princess of second-generation immigrants from Prussia and Poland. Both fathers were in the business of retail and other pioneering enterprises in California. Gertrude's father left substantial investments in land and shares in tram companies in San Francisco, which his eldest son, Michael, turned into a fortune, the kind of fortune that can commission Corbusier to build you a villa in France where you don't live, thus also securing Gertrude's future. Both families traveled in Europe, both women lost their mothers young, both lived on private incomes, which were, quote, not high enough to be taxed in France, but then we all know ways around things like that, but enough to live a comfortable life, at least in terms of clothes and food, about which they were both, those two things they were both very particular. So long as it was in Europe and it was simple, and it was. They met in Paris in September 1907, and Gertrude asked Alice on a date the next day, after which they remained together until her death in 1946. Gertrude was living with her older brother Leo in an apartment on Rue de Fleurus that was covered with the modernist art collected since settling there in 1903, Matisse, Cézanne, and Picasso. For a while, this was the only place that Picasso could show his work to anyone interested in it. And their Saturday salon became a famous institution amongst artists and émigrés, and a legend beyond that. They met because of a shared Jewish-American social milieu in California. Alice and her friend were visiting the older Steins, Michael and family, who lived nearby. The Gertrude that Alice met was already known for the salon and its openness to anyone and, quote, was just seeing through the press Three Lives, her first published novel, which was having, she was having privately printed and was deep in the making of Americans. The novel, The Making of Americans, which she wrote at night, through the night. Quickly, Alice took on the key role of typing up Gertrude's nightly productions, a role she performed for decades. They were living together within a year, sidelining Leo, who got a studio elsewhere. He never painted, by the way, according to Gertrude, and was shunted out finally in 1914. Brother and sister never spoke again. Three, what did Alice do? Well, she, I should say she's most famous, as you know, for the cookbook, the Alice B. Toklas cookbook, which was published in the 60s, I think, and she asked some friends, it has lots of very strange recipes in it, or arcane ones, and she asked friends to contribute, and Brian Gysin sent one for hash brownies, which she didn't get, and published it and was a bit pissed about it. Well, maybe she wasn't, but she said publicly she was pissed about it. But meanwhile, what did she do? So let's just draw focus on their passion, the love and work. I'm going to read from Diane Suami's glorious Gertrude and Alice biography, which is from 1991, which lays this out. Nothing detracts from Gertrude's commitment to what she later described as 30 minutes of writing a day, thrown down in small notebooks, which you'll see in a minute, in a barely legible hand. But, as she said, to be sure all day and every day you are waiting around to write that half hour a day. That's where Alice steps up. So I'm just going to read this, if you'll bear with me. Our pleasure is to do every day the work of that day, wrote Gertrude, to cut our hair and not want blue eyes, and to be reasonable and obedient, to obey and not split hairs. Every day we get up and say, we are awake today. Alice's work of the day was to serve Gertrude, who liked to read, write, wander around, drive cars and talk. Alice was secretary, cook, publisher, housekeeper, and ministering angel. She did the knitting, sewing, housekeeping, dusting, it's a very long list, typing, oh, and this is abbreviated, ordered books from Mudie's lending library in London, supplied etymologies of words, references for poets, pronunciations of Spanish, corrected Gertrude's French, kept the house filled with acacia, honeysuckle, roses, and tulips, answered the telephone, did the filing, carried Gertrude's bag, and served all meals promptly. When they went on holiday, Alice did the packing. On Saturday salon evenings, while Gertrude talked to the creative men, Alice sat with the wives of geniuses, they referred to it as, or showed them around the kitchen. And of course, she supervised the cooking. The food was extremely important. Alice made elaborate preparations for the Saturday salons. She is very necessary to me, my sweetie. She is all to me. This is one of Gertrude's notes, Irresistible. Wrote Gertrude, who was freed from all domestic chores and could concentrate on her work. It's hard work being a genius. You have to sit around doing so much, doing nothing, she said. Fortunately for Alice, being a genius did not take up all of Gertrude's time. So, four, the Rhone. In 1924, led by Alice's passion for cooking and the guide des gourmets, they visited Monsieur Penolet's hotel in Belly. The food was disappointing, but the place was not, and they returned summer after summer until renting a chateau in Belignan in 1929, where they spent the majority of the year until losing legal battles to stay during the Second World War, whereupon they moved a few kilometres away to Culoz, staying until late 1944. Love's work continued in the same ways in Paris and in Belly, where Gertrude developed ways of writing to the rhythms of cars and streets when accompanying Alice on her errands, her own splashing in the bath, their dog lapping water, and the ringing of a cowbell in the fields. She wrote Composition as Explanation, a first ever lecture given at Cambridge, while sitting on the running boards of a Ford car for hours in the garage where their own Ford was being repaired, for example. It's in that lecture that she speaks of rendering the quote, the continuous present, a using everything, a beginning again and again, end of quote. Like the frames in cinematic film. Another text was produced using a cow and a field. As Gertrude moved her writing stool about, she instructed Alice to prod the cow into movement too, thus ringing that bell. This is her handwriting. There must be hundreds of little books like this, which Alice dutifully typed up night after night or day after day. So plain editions. By the late 1920s, a wide range of attempts to get published had almost all ended in disappointment or argumentation. One portrait of Mabel Dodge had been published privately by Mabel Dodge, which led to the small press publication of Tender Buttons. But despite partial French translations of other portraits and bits of The Making of Americans, Gertrude faced her 50s in an unreceptive world, which nevertheless was happy to publish parodies of her. Easy to do. Now Alice came into her own and took up the project of publishing Gertrude's work herself, financed by the sale of a Blue Period Picasso. The plain editions were born, and the first release was Gertrude's novel, Lucy Church Amiably. And I love these books, which is why I have gone and done this in the British Library recently, because I love the fact that you can go to the British Library and touch these books. Anyone can. And there weren't very many printed. Huh? This was written to the rhythms of waterfalls and streams on the mountainside whilst Alice embroidered beside her. The church was in a hamlet close to Billignan and bore a Russian steeple, incidentally, brought back from Napoleonic campaigning. That was the picture the church she was standing in before. When Lucy was published, Gertrude, now 56, wandered around Paris, delighting at every sight of it. Quote, she had never seen a book of hers in a bookstore window before, end of quote. Lucy was designed to look like a school book. Okay, maybe I'll go back to it. but it was priced at $3, as you can see, in 1931. So Alice found other printers, but struggled to keep the costs down. She wrote in the autobiography of Alice B. Toklas, Gertrude Stein's readers are writers, university students, librarians, and young people who have very little money. Gertrude Stein wants readers, not collectors. In spite of herself, her books have too often become collectors' books. They pay big prices for Tender Buttons and the portrait of Mabel Dodge, and that does not please her. She wants her books read, not owned. Five. Oh, let me just skip through that. After the autobiography was published and she was an immediate success and proper celebrity, she did a tour in the States and found that everybody she met on the street knew who she was, which was a bit of a shock after these years of writing away in relative obscurity. And one of the things that she did when she was there was to record some of the portraits and an interview and so on. So this is a tiny fragment of one of those, which is, if I told him, a portrait of Picasso. The full version is online and you can find it, but I thought you might like to hear a little bit, which should start now.
This is a portrait that was written very much later than the one about Matisse. So although I wrote one of Picasso at that time, this was written after I knew him very much better. It's called If I Told Him, a Completed Portrait of Picasso. If I told him, would he like it? Would he like it if I told him? Would he like it? Would Napoleon? Would he like it? If Napoleon, if I told him, if I told him, if Napoleon, would he like it if I told him, if I told him, if Napoleon? Would he like it if Napoleon, if I told him? If I told him, if Napoleon, if I told him? If I...
Let us stop.
I do recommend you dig up the full version of that, because it's one of my favourite things that's ever been committed to recording. Six. Me, 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 you, me. The plain editions made little impact, but Gertrude's reputation was actual. In 1931, Edmund Wilson included her in the company of great modernists, conventional great modernists, Yeats and Eliot in Axel's Castle, even though she was virtually unpublished, approaching 60 and had played out her hand. Alice had done all she could too and reputedly vocalised a shared frustration, suggesting that a memoir would sell. And so we circle back to the autobiography of Alice B. Toklas, which wasn't, of course, an autobiography. What was it? One thing it was is suggested by Gertrude's hand on the first manuscript pages, a way to get hold of money to give the woman she loved. She also wrote in Standards in Meditation that it was written, quote, partly from need, partly from pride, and partly from ambition, end of quote. Primarily, it was also an autobiography, but not of Alice. It was a biography, not one authored from outside, but from inside, albeit in another's voice. I linger with this because, while this is one of the most conventional prose-like works of Gertrude's, it is also properly strange. That is, Gertrude adopted Alice's recognisable voice. Everyone that knew them read it in Alice's voice, recognised it, and exercised as many Gertrude-isms, which, as you can tell, if you already know, but you can tell from this already, are pretty distinctive, as she could identify, though definitely not all of them, to write a memoir of her own life and times. Quote, for the first time in writing, I felt something outside me while I was writing. End of quote. I can't think of any, let alone many, other examples. Even so, it ends like this. I'm a pretty good housekeeper and a pretty good gardener, etc., 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 that long list, and I find it difficult to add being a pretty good author. About 6 weeks ago, Gertrude Stein said, it does not look to me as if you were going to write that autobiography. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to write it for you. I'm going to write it as simply as Defoe did the autobiography of Robinson Crusoe. And she has, and this is it. May I read a couple of quotes that Gertrude gave after this extraordinary success that she had? And one of them's to her publisher in New York. She said, remember, this extraordinary welcome I'm having does not come from the books of mine that they do understand, like the autobiography, but the books of mine that they did not understand. And now she's been commissioned to do all sorts of things. She's earning money and she's delighted and really enjoys spending it. And she said, what I did had a value that made people ready to pay. Up to that time, everything I did had a value because nobody was ready to pay. Seven, Ada, a final anecdote about their first direct collaboration. It's quite an Einstein-like portrait, a sketch of Alice's early life in San Francisco. And I'll just read it. One Sunday evening in 1908, when Alice was serving supper, Gertrude came into the kitchen waving a tiny notebook, saying it must be read immediately. Called Ada, the story was all about Alice and her idyllic relationship with someone who loved her. It was the first of Gertrude's portraits of people she knew. In The Making of Americans, she wrote about everyone who had ever lived. In her portraits, she wrote about everyone she knew. Alice collaborated on Ada, and it became a joint declaration of their love. The last section of Ada goes like this, and I've cut it a bit, but this is the end of it. She came to be happier than anybody else who was living then. It is easy to believe this thing. She was telling someone who was loving every story that was charming. Someone who was living was almost always listening. That one was then one, always completely listening. Ada was then one, and all her living then one, completely telling stories that were charming, completely listening to stories, having a beginning and a middle and an ending. Alice added the last three lines. Trembling was all living, living was all loving. Someone was then the other one. Certainly this one was loving this Ada then. And certainly Ada, all her loving, then was happier in the living than anyone else could ever, whoever could, who was, who is, whoever will be living. This is important. 20 years after this, Gertrude became famous for writing about herself in Alice's voice. And here, Alice does the same thing, adopting Gertrude's voice to write her own portrait. So you see, this is a story of passion, love, and work. I should tell you, say that this and the next image are, as you can see from 1940, they are kind of IDs for Gertrude and Alice, obtained in Belly. And Belly was part of the what they called the Free Zone, which we now refer to as the Vichy regime area of France, under Pétain, controversially, and so on. But that's where they were. And this is what it looked like whilst they sat through the Second World War in a village in the Rhône Valley. So eight en famille. Early in the Second World War, the American consul suggested that they flee Billingham and offered safe passage, but village friends said, quote, one is always better where one belongs than hunting a refuge. Everybody knows you here. Everybody likes you. We all would help you in every way. Why risk yourself among strangers? Someone else said, here in this little corner, we are en famille. Gertrude said similar things, adding, here we are and here we stay. She illustrated this with the story of a village friend lending them money to live on for 6 months. And that could have been an open-ended thing. But after that time, Gertrude sold the Cézanne, portrait of his wife, or as she said, they ate the Cézanne. Thereafter, they lived in similar, if increasingly frugal ways, elaborate cooking when possible, and it was, though meat was extremely scarce, gardening / food growing, and very frequent walks out in which Gertrude would return with bread and cakes, carrying up to 5 kgs on 12 to 18 kilometer walks in the mountains, where she would run into the resistance who were hiding out there. There were German soldiers stationed all around them, with a base at Culoz station, which was a major junction, hundreds and hundreds of troops. They took it over as a base, sometimes in their house, with Italians also invading later on. Finally, with Allied troops landing and working their way up Italy and through France, Gertrude wrote in August 1944 that, quote, Alice Toklas has just commenced typewriting this book, Wars I Have Seen. It's the third volume of autobiography, and I recommend it to you. It's a wonderful book. As long as there were Germans around, we left it in manuscript. As my handwriting is so bad, it was not likely that any German would be able to read it, end of quote. So that's them in the village, presumably slightly dressed up for liberation. And there's one more image, conquering terraces. This last image is a favorite of mine and dates from June 1945, when Gertrude and Alice were offered a visit by the American troops they'd befriended and put up. Gertrude wrote an article called Off We All Went to See Germany, for I think it was for Life magazine, about their thrilling and triumphant visit to the Berghof, Hitler's home in Berchtesgaden, from where color film exists of him and senior Nazis gesturing over the Austrian valley in ways you can imagine. I love this for being an image of impossibility which condenses their work and lives. Think of it as performance poetry. It also has caused dim-witted controversy and is ill understood, but remains significant and exquisite too, rather like all of Gertrude's work. What did David Bowie sing? Now, ain't that just like me? Not me, Gertrude, obviously. Within months of that photograph, Gertrude was dead. She initially refused an operation in April 46, travelled a couple of hundred kilometres from Paris to rest and was taken ill, dying of ovarian cancer on an operating table within a week.
So much, Guy. I've got a couple of questions before I'm going to hand it over to James, and then we'll have a conversation at the end. But my first question, or observation maybe, Guy, you started saying that you could have maybe done the whole talk on their hats.
Yes.
I could imagine the whole talk done about their haircuts.
Yeah.
And, you know, it reminds me of something a friend of mine said that, you know, there's a history of the world that could be told, perhaps the most accurate history of the world, which is entirely through haircuts.
Yes.
And it seems, you know, on Wednesday we were talking about how Charles and Ray Eames, again, they were documenting themselves, but they were always somehow, they were dressing with each other. In a kind of like hyper-real way that somehow spoke about the optimism of Technicolor America in the 50s. It's hard to overemphasize, isn't it, just how radical these haircuts were when they were happening.
Yes.
Alice's
was, I mean, her haircut was designed around a big mole, which actually I've never seen, so it maybe didn't exist, but apparently a big ugly mole here. So she had this big fringe in that kind of... in a way, and that might be the whole story. But Gertrude's
the rest could have been long.
Yeah, and I encourage. Well, exactly. Or it could have been all sorts of things. And I would say, you know, hey, just share it, man, with the world, because I think, you know, don't be shy. No? But there is something to say about dress. But Gertrude's hair cut was super radical. I mean, I think it's 1927 she got it cut, and she just said. Actually, an overtly fashionable friend, Parisian friend, had her hair cut short, and Gertrude said to Alice, you know, cut my hair. And she started cutting and didn't know what she was doing and kept cutting the next day, and then sort of eventually there wasn't much left to cut, and that was the haircut. Because before that she had this kind of Victorian kind of long hair up bun on the top of her head.
Was it poodleish?
It was poodleish, and I thought you were going to say poopish. It sort of, a fascinating mixture of the two. And that haircut was just brilliant, no? Because it's her sentences and modernity in a haircut, of course. And then in terms of clothes, she was before they met, you know, had a kind of characteristic uniform of corduroys, brown corduroys, and sandals and stuff. And then those waistcoats she had specially commissioned. And then Alice, they were both obsessed, actually, about their clothes and getting them made. And that's where a lot of this money went. That's the comfort of the private income. That was what it was spent on. And the hats, there's lots of hats. And they're just a wonder. But one of them, there was a picture of that very sort of stern... portrait of Gertrude with that funny little hat there. That one, I think, was something like a kind of Napoleonic colonel's hat or something like that, which Alice saw and got made for Gertrude. So.
And then maybe we can move from hair, clothing, to house. There was that beautiful iteration of Alice's roles in the house in particular. Mm. It was almost a sort of checklist of domesticity down to the flowers and so on and so forth. And I mean, is there a sense in which the space and the efficiency, the ambience of the house takes on a particular quality for a writer? And, you know, is she also in that sense a co-writer by producing the conditions in which Gertrude's writing happens?
Yeah, I think so. It's kind of what you would want as a writer, someone who does all those things, which betrays a very deep understanding of what is needed, and it's not something you could tell someone. So, you know, you could pay someone theoretically to do all of these things, but you'd have to constantly tell them and monitor it. So Alice was unbelievably diligent in all of those tasks. I mean, she would get up, they had a servant, they had a maid in this small flat, two-bedroom flat in Paris, who was like, they make much of the different grades of servants. So she was a kind of servant that could produce a good souffle. And they noticed after some years that some of their artist friends could also afford a servant that could produce a good souffle. So there's a thing about that. But she would get up at, a couple of hours before the servant arrived to clean the things properly and more thoroughly and start preparing food before the servant, the maid came. And similarly, you know, in the countryside, the same story. So she did a lot of stuff. You know, Gertrude, by the way, got up whenever she felt like it, which was quite late. So a huge amount had happened already in the day before she got up and then did what she had to do. But
this also kind of corroborates a stereotype of, I mean, she used the word herself, of a kind of, a genius in what they do, but complete, utter ineptitude.
Yes.
In the basics of living.
Mm, mm.
And therefore, you know, there needs to be this sort of pragmatic, well, again, if you're extremely lucky, a sort of pragmatic partner who somehow looks after. I remember there's a very famous graphic designer. I'm not going to name him. Very famous, very iconic. And then I happened to meet, I got to know his partner.
Mm.
And, we were talking about him and his mythology, and she said, well, you know, I can't think of him in those terms because I have to deal with sending his underwear from East to West London to be dry cleaned and then come back. And suddenly with that one thing, she somehow managed to prick and burst the kind of myth of this hero for me. Now I can only think about the shuttling of his underwear back and forth across London. But again, that it spoke of this, in a way, a couple format, right? The part of the role of the genius is to luxuriate in the fact that they can't do their laundry.
Yeah, yeah.
And was there a sense in which that this played some of that out?
I think so. I mean, I think it grew. So, I mean, when they met, Alice was what Gertrude needed without knowing that that's what she needed.
Mm.
And Alice had, what she got out of it was this dependency. I mean, a lot of their friends have written and recorded their sense that Alice was kind of in control. She would vet social contacts as they, you know, very severely. I mean, she'd make people she didn't like were out, especially women who maybe she caught smiling at Gertrude and stuff like that. And also, one of the things I love about it is that Gertrude could drive. She could also clip their hedges during the war. She got to do that, and she was really proud of that. But when she drove, and I love this, because this is how geniuses drive, she just went wherever she felt like it. So if she wanted to go, Alice would say, we need to take a right here by the church, she'd just go left, and things like that all the time. And although it might be a little tricky to live with a partner like that, as some of you may do, or have done, you know, I don't know, there's something gorgeous about it. Of course, it would be easy to underplay just how integral Alice is to this whole project. I don't know. I hope I'm not doing that because, it's not just that she produced a cookbook which kind of reclaimed some of her status, but she was absolutely integral to this thing happening. And I think she felt that, you know, she knew it. Gertrude certainly did, you know.
Fantastic. Okay, a few more things, but I'm going to leave them till after our next guest. Do you guys want to swap seats? Or are you okay?
No, I'm all right.
Okay, great. So our next guest is James Westcott. James is the author of When Marina Abramović Dies, a biography, and I'm really looking forward to talking about biography and autobiography in a minute. James was co-editor of Rem Koolhaas and Hans-Ulrich Obrist's Project Japan, and he was editor of Elements of Architecture for Koolhaas's Venice Architecture Biennial in 2014. How many pages was that? 2,500 pages.
Wow.
James now works as a story developer and script editor for film and television projects here in London. Will you please join in welcoming James Westcott, Marina Abramović and Ulay.
Thanks very much, Shumon, and thanks everyone for coming. So I want to start with a song. I'm not going to sing it as a kind of overture. Last month, I was lucky enough to see Bruce Springsteen at Wembley Stadium, and he sung a song I've never heard before. I'll Work for Your Love. So I'm going to try to play it on YouTube. I hope this works. I hope it's not too loud.
Pour me a drink, Teresa, one of those glasses you dust off.
Oh, can't do that. Okay.
Round your head.
All right, we'll listen from the beginning. Sorry. That's the key part. So what I love about this song is the defiant and almost adolescent sense that love can be earned, that it can be about just putting in sufficient effort, sweat, and sheer willpower, and then you can conquer the one you want. You can attain love, almost like working out in the gym or winning a strenuous game of basketball. If applying the same discipline to love, to a relationship, as you would to training for a marathon, and you feel that the character in the song feels, oh, okay, I can. If it's about that, I can do that. That's no problem. And somehow that's an attractive bargain, because if love is only about effort and willpower, then it's easy to practice. You can wear down the opposition of the other. You can put them in your debt. And most of all, emotions and doubt can be kind of short-circuited, drowned in sweat. So the reason I bring this up is because it kind of touches on the idea of contract and covenant. And that's a theme I want to cover in this talk. Basically, he's kind of trying to take a contract and give it the force of covenant just through sheer willpower. And that's what I think Marina and Ulay attempted to do over their 13 years together as performance artists and lovers from 76 to 88. A contract, what is a contract? It's a list of the conditions underpinning a conditional relationship. I'll keep doing this for you as long as you keep doing this for me. It's essentially a consumer relationship, because as soon as something else better comes along, or as soon as some of the conditions aren't being met by either party, the contract is null and void. You're free to go. A contract is performance-based, but a covenant is unconditional. It's permanent. Whatever happens, it's not based on performance. Along the lines of God's, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you, Hebrews 13:5. The key point is that Springsteen's character in the song, presuming he's not married to the woman he's singing to, is as I said, trying to elevate a contract to a covenant. So who were Marina and Ulay before they became Abramović and Ulay together as a compound? So in the early 70s, Marina was, she was born in Belgrade, and she was doing performances by herself, trying to escape the strictures of academic painting, where she started. And she was wrestling with these symbols of the communist state. Here, maybe she was trying to convert the communist star into a, a fiery pentagram that she was sacrificing herself in. But worse than Tito's regime was the tyranny that she was under in her mother's house. So after doing this crazy performance, she had to be home by 10 p.m. She still had a she still had a curfew at the age of 28. Marina was married already when she met Ulay to a guy called Nessa Peripovic. He was in her collective of artists. Here they are signing the contract in a very dour ceremony. And I think this picture sums up what their marriage was like. I don't think her heart was ever in it. But even this didn't please her mother. They never lived together. Her mother wouldn't allow Nessa to move in. So it was sort of a marriage only on paper. And meanwhile, Marina was traveling around Europe doing performances like this, and Nessa never traveled with her. So,
James, what did he do?
He was a performance artist as well. Yeah, he did some nice stuff. But Marina was just prolific and on another level. So she was performing solo, and she's putting herself in situations of increasing danger. Meanwhile, who was Ulay? He was born in a bomb shelter in the Rhineland in 1943. And by 1968, he had a family, he had a profession, he developed photos, he had a processing store. But the pressures of a professional life and a family life were too much for him, and he just ran away. He drove to Prague, but it happened to be the Prague Spring at the time, so the border was closed. He wanted to attend film school, so he just decided to go to Amsterdam because there was some trouble going on there as well that he was interested in. So he got to Amsterdam and he immersed himself in the transvestite scene, and he would go to parties and hand around his Polaroid camera like a drug almost, and everyone would use it, and then he would do actions like this. So from the beginning, Ulay, not exactly divided, but like worse than divided, sort of dissolved, dissipated. He never felt that he had a coherent identity from the beginning. And from the beginning, he was looking for someone to enfold himself in, someone to collaborate with, or more than collaborate with, just someone to absorb himself into. Started off with this German artist called Jürgen Klauke. They did a kind of duel, and they also did a Russian roulette performance. Then he met a woman called Paula, and he tried to put on her boots. They wouldn't fit, so he cut on his foot where, you know, the mark that he, as far as he could put them on. So he was doing like really destructive, even more destructive things than Marina. And again, he was trying to mirror, double, absorb, kind of integrate himself with someone else, anyone. On Christmas 1974, he sent his season's greetings to friends and family, not as a Christmas card, but in the form of a memorial card, the type you send when somebody dies. And it read, Ulay, 1943 to 1974, mein Abscheid als einziger Person, my farewell as a single person. So it was his symbolic suicide as an individual. As if we think about the full meaning of that word, one integrated person, indivisible. He wasn't interested in that. This was still 2 years before he met Marina, but he was clearly rehearsing for a spectacular symbiosis with somebody. But nobody could quite surrender to the level of absorption that he wanted. Cue Marina visiting Amsterdam in 1976. This is how Ulay first saw her. Actually, he was friends with the gallerist who invited her, and he was assigned to be her chaperone as she landed at the airport. So, of course, he was amazingly impressed by this performance, and said that he kind of retreated with her afterwards and nursed her wounds, and that was...
Can you describe what happened in this performance?
Yeah, it's called Thomas Lips, and she cut a pentagram on her stomach and then whipped herself and then drank a kilo of honey and then lay on a crucifix made of ice.
Did she still have to get home by 10 p.m.?
not from Amsterdam, no. but this was actually an ode to her lover, or a sort of a lover who didn't love her. So she was in a very different place, but the kind of consummation really happened when they realized they shared a birthday, November 30th. and Marina received the invitation for this performance on November 30th. And then they were at dinner that night, and Marina said, your birthday can't be November 30th. And he said, I'll prove it to you. Here's my diary. Look, the page is ripped out. And she said, that's impossible. Here, my November 30th is also ripped out. So they both had this obsession and hatred of their own birthday. So from the beginning, their relationship had this cosmic significance, and their kind of union was inevitable. So they didn't get married, but they did write a manifesto together. It's called the Art Vital Manifesto. They bought this Citroen HY van, and they hit the road. They lived in the van, and their relationship would consist of a set of ideals and pure ambition to see what their bodies could do together. This contract between them became so stringent that it gathered the force of a covenant. And each individual performance in itself was like entering into an individual covenant. There was no question of breaking the conditions of each performance. It was like a religion, basically, that they invented. This is the back of their van, meticulously organized, the filing cabinet, books strapped down, shoes nicely organized, their clothes. So if great relationships need to be about a third thing, theirs was about performative mode of living on the road. They lived in a kind of fantasy, borderless Europe that didn't really exist at the time, since Europe was still a kind of burned and blasted and divided place after the war, but they created their own Schengen zone in a way. They just floated around Europe, going from performance to performance, chasing invitations and kind of vacationing in Istria. And having fun. Marina would take on the traditionally feminine roles in a relationship, cooking, cleaning, knitting, entertaining, and charming the art world, most of all. Abramović lapped up the adulation, whereas Ulay hid from it. Ulay would handle paperwork and finances. Marina was around 30 or maybe even a bit older, and she still never had had a bank account in her life. So they were getting, they were starting to become symbiotic. They called each other glue. As I said, they never got married, but maybe the closest they came to a ceremony of something like that was getting the number 3 tattooed on their ring finger. And maybe that 3 was about the third thing beyond themselves. The tattoos faded, though, after a few years. Here they are arriving at the Venice Biennale in 1976, looking like movie stars, and Ulay's growing his hair, trying to catch up with Marina so he can really mirror her. This is their performance, naked, simply running into each other and kind of bouncing off each other. Ulay was physically stronger, so it was usually Marina who fell over. But this is, the microphones here are interesting. I mean, they were always so aware of their own production as a performance unit and emphasizing the slapping sound of the flesh and even the white backdrop so that photos look good. You know, it was raw and authentic, but it was also very carefully planned always, and therefore maybe theatrical. Everything in their lives was an experiment in symbiosis and even in psychic communication. Here, Ulay sewed his lips shut, and Marina took questions from the audience, but answering as Ulay, so trying to channel what he would say. Here, if running into each other was too difficult, they put a big fat wall in between each other. They were kind of making a Newtonian physics out of their relationship. Here, the walls were on the outside, and they were running at them. They were kind of movable blocks, and they were trying to, like, just shuffle them ever outwards. And this is where a competitive aspect introduced itself. After slamming themselves into these blocks for about 30 minutes, Ulay's column got stuck, and he left. He stopped his part of the performance. But Marina carried on, much to his annoyance. She got to look like the stronger of the two, like the hero. Later on, he made the excuse that he'd expended all his effort building this set in the first place, but Marina then countered with the fact that she was menstruating at the time, so it wasn't ideal for her either. So a paradox begins to seep into their work, I think, that the more raw and authentic it is, the more it feels like they're performing a series of metaphors. In a way, they get kind of trapped in a metaphor. Like, you want to say about something like this that, I don't know, you could say something, but it would remain a metaphor, you know, either confronting the reflection of the other or trying to break through or whatever. But I don't know, I just think that's an interesting aspect, that they're kind of creating metaphors, but always trying to punch through them into something very physical and real. In Bologna, they did an experiment wondering which way people would face as they squeezed through them in a doorway. Women went the predictable way and men went the predictable way. It was also an experiment in symbiosis, but a symbiosis that quickly becomes an accelerated form of entropy since it's a closed loop. Here they just swapping a lung full of air between them. They managed to do it for 20 minutes, but since it's a closed loop, no oxygen can get in, and so, you know, they would die if they did it indefinitely. This is a kind of calmer form of symbiosis, creating an umbilical cord. Again, you kind of reach for a metaphor. They sat together alone for 16 hours like this and then let an audience in, just to sort of see what kind of, you know, when somebody's been awake all night and they've got a really different, you can tell if someone's been awake all night, kind of like that. Their performances must have been incredibly cathartic, releasing pent-up rage. Here they made a kind of slapping rhythm on their thighs and then on each other's faces. And here they yelled at each other in each other's mouth almost until they lost their voices. And here they're going for shorter haircuts, but again, mirroring each other. The most literal and the most dangerous of all their performances is this one, Rest Energy. Kind of speaks for itself. Except that they had microphones on their hearts. So again, kind of upping the drama of it. So the space reverberated with the sound of their accelerating heartbeats. Here we start to see a turn in their work. We're into the early or mid-80s now. Here, basically trying to see how close they can get their fingers to each other without touching, you know, that kind of game. So they were wondering by this point how much further they could go with inflicting pain or kind of screaming or yelling or kind of expending energy. Instead, they wondered if they could charge energy, create energy between themselves by doing as little as possible. So in the Australian desert, in the stillness of that, they came up with this idea for a performance called Night Sea Crossing, where they would simply sit across each other on a table and remain locked in eye contact and not move for the duration of an entire day in a museum or a gallery. So from opening time to closing time, so people coming in would never see them moving. They'd appear to be statues. So even this most cosmic of relationships, freighted with almost unbearably weighty significance and pushed to the limits of mental and physical tolerance, even this was subject to familiar banalities of being in a couple, being bored at home in Amsterdam, dutiful visits to the in-laws in a kind of small village in the Rhineland, temper tantrum in China, a happier moment in Hydra. Ulay looks, I don't know what he looks like here, a depressing 40th birthday party for Ulay in New York. The look he's giving Marina here seems to sum up their relationship at this point. Things are starting to come apart. He almost, it's like he's sneering at her, and she just looks like she's fuming. And he was already having affairs at this point, and Marina was having her revenge affairs, and it was becoming ugly. And Ulay had revealed at this point that he had a son that he'd never spoken about for 10 years. So, you know, complete transparency and going to the edge in performances is, of course, no guarantee of doing the same in your private life. But they had a contract, a promise they'd made to each other. They'd stated that they would perform Night Sea Crossing not just once, but 90 times. That's 90 days. Not 90 consecutive days, but kind of in chunks around the world at whatever museum would have them. So it would actually be nice to get all the images and sort of compare all the museum interiors around the world. So they did it, you know, in a basement, at Documenta, in a plaza, even in a... Oh, my mouse is... Gone missing, even in a pit in Japan, And every day got worse than the last, and they would push themselves to the point of having hallucinations. Actually, I did a version of this performance when it was in Moscow, and just staring at someone for, I think it was an hour, and you do start to hallucinate. Like, your brain is just so bored with the face in front of you that it starts to project, like, incredible different kinds of faces. So they were going through these really crazy mental trips, and Ulay, because he was so skinny, his butt bones would just rub on the chair, and he was getting, like, the equivalent of bed sores. And eventually he walked away from one of the performances because he just couldn't stand it anymore. And then, so that was another victory for Marina. So that was another source of a fight later on. So it wasn't really symbiosis anymore. It was a competition. But they had this promise and they had this plan. For years, they've been planning to walk the length of the Great Wall of China. Marina would start in the east, Ulay would start in the west, and they would simply walk towards each other. So when they started planning this in the early 80s, they thought, okay, this is our marriage ceremony. We'll meet in the middle and get married. But by the time they planned it all and got permission, their relationship was falling apart. So it turned into the most spectacular divorce ceremony in history. I think it took them 3 months to do the walk alone, kind of thinking. The meeting in the middle was still amicable, maybe because they knew it was, they both knew it was over at this time. So 10 years later, there was a new contract, this time nothing like a covenant, purely a legal document full of conditions of a new conditional relationship. Basically, Marina was looking to accelerate her career at this point, and Ulay was still in retreat. Marina bought out the entire archive, all their shared works. She bought it for about 200,000 euros, taking a massive financial risk at that point because she wasn't an art star then. She borrowed all the money. She made a huge gamble. And Ulay, in a way, was happy to be free of this legacy, purged of also the physical burden of looking after this work. So now we have a kind of very depressing legalistic contract. And this is the key clause. If Marina sold the work, she would get more of the proceeds than he would. But the wording of this clause would soon cause trouble. So since this time, since the breakup, there would be long periods of animosity over perceived injustices, like, you showed my work here, you didn't credit me properly. Really, like, divorced parents of work, basically. Work was their child. And but there were also long periods of détente and, you know, quite beautiful reconciliations, culminating in this one in 2010. You might know this because it's their most popular piece ever, although it wasn't a performance, 28.5 million views. So Marina was in New York doing a version of Night Sea Crossing, but with members of the public instead. And on opening night, Ulay was there, and to Marina's surprise, when she was looking down, when she looked up, he was the person staring at her. And they broke the rules of the performance and kind of joined hands, and someone underscored it with emotional music, and it became an internet hit, and it is really moving, actually. But the ending is a sad one. 6 years later, Ulay is now suing Marina because he interpreted that clause in the contract differently than she did. So they're kind of now ending in quite an ugly place. So at first, they tried to force a contract into a covenant. The covenant didn't work because somehow they wanted to skip, like, the key thing that makes a covenant, like, they wanted to do it through willpower alone. And maybe that's why it failed. So in the end, there wasn't a covenant, and now there's not even a contract, unfortunately. So that's the end of this little thing. Thanks.
The first thing is, I'm wondering whether in your conversations with Marina and with Ulay, the other kind of celebrity couple that seems to just predate them, which is John Lennon and Yoko Ono, is that anywhere in the ether? Because that one image of them sort of spooning each other. Mm. And for you, you know, you're talking about this in terms of like a project of symbiosis and of erosion again, of the boundary between him and her, seemed to be something that John and Yoko, again, also embarked upon as a massive public performance. And right down to the songwriting, you know, we think of, we you know, we often still tend to think of John Lennon as the doing the records and Yoko Ono being the artist, but that's rubbish, right? Like, they also, authorship was completely intermingled. And was that anywhere in this, or just like coincidence that this couple, this symbiotic couple, came after that one?
It never came up. Yeah. I'm sure that Marina wouldn't like the comparison.
Of course.
Yeah, and then, I mean, the great thing about Marina and Ulay is that they really did, you know, the parity was amazing. You know, you couldn't separate who was doing what, and they were kind of coming into themselves at the same time and coming to the height of their creative powers at the same time. And they also didn't have celebrity status, those two, obviously. So I'm afraid not, no.
And there was something that you said early on, which was that you said great relationships need to be about a third thing. Could you expand it on that? It's really intriguing.
I think that's what Marina and Ulay had, obviously, with the performances. But funnily enough, that third thing ended up eating them alive, because they, like, basically, I think you need a third thing to avoid idolizing your partner, who will only let you down because they're a human being. So if you've both got a third thing to concentrate on, then you won't be disappointed. But I think they turned their third thing into an idol, and it consumed them. So actually, the model can fail too.
Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering whether that would apply for Gertrude and Alice as well, or not.
I think it probably worked for them, right? In the third thing was the work and the struggle to get it published, which probably mirrors the kind of thing that you might have if the work was children, you know, that you look after no matter what happens, mm-hmm. and you want to put everything into it, and it's really a long-term project, and there's always a question mark about how much you get back for what you put in and all of that stuff, which, you know. I mean, if, for example, her work had suddenly been published in the, you know, when it was written, it may be a very different story for that kind of reason, I guess.
Yeah, children is an interesting thing, because Ulay wanted children, but Marina never did. She always thought of the work as the child, and she knew that she would be incredibly distracted. You know, she'd be knocked off course if she had a child, and she was too focused for that. So, I think Ulay, in a way, eventually wanted a more normal life. And she just wasn't interested in that at all. Mm-hmm.
And then another thing that you said, which seems to maybe be the caption for the whole story, which is you described an accelerated form of entropy. And you also talked about them almost performing like a Newtonian physics. And that's also, I mean, it's a beautiful kind of metaphor. Talking about how the work becomes metaphor, but it also almost feels like at the beginning they were authors of their entropy, or they were in control of it. Whereas towards the latter, they're almost victims of that entropy. Like the entropy takes over.
Yeah.
They become subjects to the authorship by entropy itself. Right.
So, yeah.
And that the final act, or the final performance of the lovers on the Great Wall, is this epic attempt to reinstate their control over the fact that they've lost control, something like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and actually, it's so interesting that the different ways that Marina and Ulay approached that walk.
Yeah.
Of course, they were confronted by bureaucracy and things they didn't understand along the way, and like Chinese not understanding what they were doing and kind of trying to stop them or trying to make it easier for them in different ways. And Marina had a policy from the beginning, like, of just surrender. But Ulay was always about like pure authenticity, like hardcore, and like he didn't want to take a detour around the nuclear waste site. He wanted to walk through it and had to have physical fights with Chinese people, and like just made the whole thing really unpleasant and arduous for himself, exactly because he wanted to retain control. But interestingly, Marina, you know, who's fanatically controlling in her bureaucratic life and kind of managing her stardom and in the performance itself, but she always knows that the goal in the end is to surrender, even within the performance.
And if there are any questions, please do put your hand up. I'm wondering if, I mean, obviously that relationship that they had was the work. Did Marina have any other relationships after Ulay?
Yeah, she was married. She had a relationship that probably lasted like 8 years or so. Mm-hmm. And she was married, and for a while it seemed like that was that would be it. But they divorced maybe 6 or 7 years ago. Mm-hmm. An Italian artist. They deliberately never collaborated. Mm-hmm. But in the end, I think she thought that the very fact that he was an artist, that was already made it impossible. Yeah. So that became one of her rules. Artists should never marry artists.
A question, I think, for both Guy and James. I just want like the comparison between individuals and couples, because in Goethe's Sorrows of Young Werther, Werther says, when you're happy and in love, he couldn't paint when he was happy and in love. He could only paint when he wasn't. And I think Camus as well, in his diaries, he noted that celibacy is a crucial condition for creativity. So I was wondering whether, and I relate to these, both of them, Werther and Camus, in that sort of sense. I can only produce in the sort of that whenever I'm out of love or out of relationship. So I don't know whether when it's a couple, maybe it is that third thing that James mentioned that drives the couple into producing, when that thing, it doesn't exist when you're individual and not in a dual or a couple thing.
Well, one of the things about that little page of Gertrude's handwriting is it has this thing, lifting the belly. And there's a long poem about lifting the belly, where she wrote a lot of work in the early years of their relationship, which were quite kind of, they're quite sexual. I mean, they're very sexual. And so, and there's a full of codes for orgasms and things, like which they call cows and Caesars, and no one knows quite what the codification is. Lifting the belly is, I mean, they're quite, there's a hot eroticism about these texts, you know. So in a way, you know, and they celebrate this love, this moment of real love. And the only limit on that was that Alice was really embarrassed. She had to type these things up the next day, no? And they're kind of like, and they, you know, the word sticky does recur, for example. And given we're talking about Gertrude Stein, you know, it recurred, you know, more than, you know, quite a bit, right? So in a way that counters what, you know, what you're saying. And that's one of the singularities, maybe, of this relationship, I think.
James, did they... Other than there's obviously the manifesto, then there are these performances. Mm. Were they also documenting diaristically this accelerated entropy and privately or for each other?
No, I don't think systematically. Mm. I think Marina wrote kind of very depressed, longing letters to friends sometimes about how badly things were going, and they would even take different retreats in different places. But I think she never made that a part of the work. In a way, she wanted to keep the work pure. Like she never produced out of that depression. I think she's very romantic in many ways, but in terms of productivity, she needs a totally organized life, and she needs to be psychically and emotionally and mentally very healthy in order to produce. Not that you're not when you're alone, but she needs someone else to sort of sustain her as well.
Maybe it's worth just saying or repeating the thing about Gertrude's thing about 30 minutes a day, because in a way this is in a way the opposite. I mean, it sounds similar, so you have this very organized life, someone else does all the work, and then you do this thing. But actually, in a sense, you simply commit to doing something every day, nearly literally every day, and that then everything flows. So it can be quite chaotic. I mean, obviously during the war, it was pretty tough. But you know, she did it, and her thing was, and if you do it every day, actually, it's surprising how much it amounts to over the course of a year, you know, and which it did. So that, you know, it's not pure. Although I made it sound a bit like a perfect kind of clean space, but I don't think it was. I think it's this primary commitment to producing a bit. Mm. And if you really do that, you know, we all know this, yeah, right? If we do a bit of exercise or you know, whatever it is, every day, a little bit, it adds up.
Any other questions? If not, I have one last thing, which is to kind of make the leap from autobiography to biography. And we have a biographer here. It can't, again, be, I think, stressed enough how, in a way, strange but also brilliant the format of the autobiography of Alice B. Toklas is, right? So imagine, you know, you decide you're going to tell the story of your life to the world, but instead of using the subject I, meaning you, you're going to use the subject I, meaning him or her, who is your partner, your lover. And you're going to use that I to narrate how you feel, or how you remember your life.
So confusing.
It's an unbelievable act of like epic ventriloquism, intersubjectivity, violence, and maybe even generosity. Like, it's so many weird things. Mm. And it's extraordinary as a format, as an autobiography format. And James, I was wondering, I knew you, I remember you telling me how you started this incredible journey, your own performance, in a way, of writing, being Marina Abramović's biographer. I was wondering if you just share how that started, and then maybe talk a little bit about, because I think the relationship between a biographer and their subject, particularly if they're alive, but maybe even if they're not alive, is a couple format as well. Mm. And if you could say something about how that relationship, how you thought it might play out, and in the end, how it played out between the two of you.
Okay. Just deciding on what level of detail to start with.
How did it start? How did it?
Okay, well, it started when I went to New York to do a master's, and someone, we were reading an article about Marina and the Great Wall performance, and then coincidentally, and it blew my mind. And then the next day, someone came to class saying, "Oh, that woman, she's doing a performance in Chelsea right now." So I went there, and she was living in the gallery for 12 days. Not eating, blah blah blah, and then I wrote an article.
Well, as you do.
I wrote an article about it, and I sent it to Marina, and she contacted me, which I was amazed about, and we met, and then she found out that I was or wanted to be a writer and an editor, and she said, "I need someone to write my emails," so I became because she's of that generation, so. I became her assistant, and so she would sit. So I became her ventriloquist dummy. I would sit next to her, and she would dictate, and I'd write her emails. So I learned how to use her voice. She has a really distinctive voice and distinctive vocabulary and mangled English. So I learned that, and I typed as her, and I could kind of pull it off quite easily. I became her ghostwriter in a way, in a similar way that I did for Ren when I worked at OMA. And then there were a few specific tasks, like I had to watch the video footage of those 12 days and log it, basically, in the most dry, banal, kind of Beckett-type language. So in that way, I learned, or it helped me to be more observant and to kind of learn how to describe a performance. So those two skills sort of combined in the biography, I hope.
And then did you had the idea to write the biography?
Yeah,
it wasn't something she proposed.
No, it was my idea, and it was my proposal, and she loved the idea because, you know, she loves broadcasting her work and, you know, and getting it, setting the record straight. So you want to know kind of what happened?
Well, how does that, you know, well, maybe it's hard for you to tell us what that couple format was between you as a biography and her as a subject. And, you know, how that process kind of unfolded.
Well, it was very maternal. She always operates by charm and seduction and sort of taking, she's this, you know, larger than life Balkan personality. She takes people under their wing, and that was really nice. I needed that. I was alone and sort of penniless in New York. And she was
the name of your autobiography. Penniless and alone in New York.
She always fed. She always gave me the best meals when I came to her house to type. Like, that was all great. But, you know, that's how she operates with everyone. Like, sort of shock and awe, seduction, and you sort of pass through that, and then like, that's great, but then you don't really need that anymore, and you can kind of get a more objective viewpoint. So by the time I started writing the book, I had kind of come out the other side of that adulation, hopefully.
And how much did you, presumably you interviewed Ulay for the book?
Yeah.
And how was that part?
It was amazing. There were marathon sessions. I went to Amsterdam twice, and you know, they were like endurance performances in themselves. That was really odd because he actually loved to talk about it because he's very wistful, and he enjoys being the marginalized one, the sidelined one, the one forgotten by history. And then this was his chance to put the record straight. So yeah, it was amazing talking to him.
And could you imagine doing another biography?
Actually, maybe not. Well, I did imagine doing another biography, but it didn't come off, and of someone else. Right now, no, actually, I couldn't. Yeah. I couldn't imagine doing it, because you do have to subsume yourself in this person and think like them and become obsessed, totally obsessed with them. And I don't think I'm in a time of my life where I have that headspace anymore. Maybe in the future.
Okay, we've run out of time. Just before we thank our guests, just to remind you, format, the third one is next Wednesday. And we have couple formats of Hannah Arendt and Mary McCarthy by Céline Condorelli, and Gilles Deleuze and Felix Guattari by Aaron Schuster. So that's here, 6 p.m. next Wednesday. Have a great weekend. Please join me in thanking James Westcott and Guy Mannes-Abbott.